Right. Our next guest is an Australian singer, actor, TV personality, record producer, songwriter and barrister.
How does he do it?
Mark Holden had four top 20 hit singles in the 1970s and became a judge on Australian Idol nearly 30 years later.
He's penned a new memoir called My Idol Years, and he joins us now to spill the beans on all the backstage dramas on the talent show. Step up to the bar, please, sir. You can engage the judge and I right now. How are you, mate?
I'm well, Your Honours.
I mean, it's always great to have you on, Mark. Let's deep dive into this feud with Dicko.
Yes.
It's been reported for many years. You've written about it now. Tell us what happened.
Well, look, it's all in the book, My Idol Years. My Idol Years is about the year 2007, and 2007 was the last year that I was on Idol. I didn't know it was going to be my last year, but I foolishly agreed to allow Dicko to come back on the show for 2007 after he'd crashed and burned on every other network. And God bless him, he came on, and believe it or not, at the end of that year, he was in and I was out. He is the master bureaucrat. He is the master corporate hall walker. He had years and years and years working for BMG and in Europe and in Australia, and is a master at that. And I'm an outsider. I'm a loner. That's why being a barrister is such a perfect fit for me, because as a barrister, you can't even incorporate. You're not a member of a firm.
Mm.
You're totally a soul. You have to be totally independent.
Yeah,
and
totally.
So I was up against Dicko's machinations in the hallways.
Yes.
And he just outplayed me. The truth of the matter is, he was just in the game of corporate chess, he checkmated me and I was out and he was in.
So,
in the fullness of time, you know, God bless Dicko. He was just better at it than me, that's all.
So how's the relationship between the two of you now?
Look, Dicko is such a disarming and charming dude. It's impossible not to love Dicko. Dicko's the kind of guy that if you spend a minute with him, you will believe you are the most important person in the world. It's another great skill of his. And that's why he charms his way into so many places. So, no, look, frustration with it was that I honestly believed that we had an opportunity to be the kind of senior Hamish and Andy. And I thought we could build that together. We were thrown together, Abbott and Costello, Laurel and Hardy. These were guys that didn't necessarily like each other. But a chemistry happened, and we had a chemistry. And he thought he was going to be Simon Cowell and rule the world.
Mm-hmm.
And being Hamish and Andy in Australia was small fry for him.
It's extraordinary, you know, that this all happened before social media hit. You know, before
yes.
we had, well, Facebook was coming around that time, but no one was really on it.
Mm.
There's
That's
no
exactly
Twitter. There's
right.
no. There's none of that trolling or anything.
No.
That's
no,
now.
No.
Sure.
There were chat rooms. There were chat rooms.
Yeah,
there
but
were
you had to
chat
go
rooms.
To them.
Yes.
But you had, yeah. But they were, not pervasive. And old dudes like me were not in chat rooms unless they were, you know, pedophiles or something or other. But so we weren't. I was not involved in it at all. And that by the comparison, the Dancing with the Stars, when Bobo reared his ugly head,
oh, Bobo
yes.
the Clown, yeah,
and Putin reared his ugly belly on Dancing with the Stars, the hatred, mm. the abuse online was something that I never had experienced before. Not as a teen idol in the 70s, not as a judge on the most popular show in Australia at the time. But seriously, on Dancing with the Stars, I can't imagine what you guys have to deal with, and I know Son's had to deal with it herself. So you guys have been at the coalface.
No, well, you know, and absolutely, and it is terrible when it happens. Can I just quickly ask you? There's something you said about the industry, the entertainment industry, because you've been a part of it for so long, and you said in a recent interview that Dami Im and Guy Sebastian, who were born out of talent shows like Idol,
yes.
wouldn't be working if you didn't have those. Now, because
Correct.
The industry is basically whitewashed
Correct.
Do you stand by that?
No, I stand by that. When you consider Idol in 2001 and Guy Sebastian, why was Guy Sebastian not signed by EMI, Universal, or any of the major labels? Why? Why would you not sign a dude as obviously talented as Guy Sebastian? And I'll tell you why. Because 99.9% of the acts that this small group of A&R people and small group of record companies signed were white and male. Occasionally, a wog would get through. Occasionally, a woman would get through. But if you were Asian, forget it. I mean, really, Hush, there was Hush that was the only Asian face that I saw on my screen as a kid. In a rock band, and other than that, it was entirely a small
Juno
group
Roxas.
Of white
There were
males.
People like that. There was Juno Roxas and Kate Sobrano. There was a few people that came through that were
sure.
Of color.
Okay. Kate Sobrano. There's a second one, and you can say Marsha, of course. But Marsha was coming out of America, and she was coming out of Hair, and she was coming out of Superstar, and that was a singular journey. That was a very singular journey that's still going on. She's still, God bless Marsha, she's still, you know, hitting runs out of the park all around the country. But it was a very white record business. It was basically white rock bands and some girl singers. And that was it. That was it. There was not... A Dammy Im would never have got signed. I can tell you, it would not have happened.
Mark, you've now taken a back seat from the entertainment industry and you're working as a lawyer, as a barrister. So how is all of that going?
Well, you know, it's a great privilege to be a barrister. In a way, it's kind of like when I was a music manager and managed Vanessa and Joel and various other people. You know, you're fighting for people. That's what it is. That's what I like about it. You're fighting for people's rights when you're fighting for an artist. You know, I would go to war for her. But with being a barrister, it's much more important because it's people's whole lives. It's like, you know, if you have a surgeon who comes to you when you're very ill and you put your life in his hand, people who are, you know, have lost all their money and there's, you know, they need to get it back, or people who are accused of a crime or there's, you're getting them at their worst possible moment, and it's your job to do your very best for them. So I love that part of it. I love the fighting for people and fighting for rights and fighting for social justice. I really do get a value out of that, and I'm the duty barrister at the Family Violence Court. Every so often, I make myself available to do that as well. It's a great privilege to be a member of the Victorian Bar, and it's a ticket that I really love having. But I've written a one-man show called The Greatest Show on Earth about my family circus, and I just did 2 weeks at MTC HQ workshopping it, and I'm going to run that out next year, and that give me an opportunity to get back on the road and tell stories and sing songs.
Mark, your best years are still ahead of you, mate. You
God
are not
bless you,
done
DC.
Yet. You are not done yet, my friend. Go out and get Mark's memoir. It's called My Idol Years. Case closed, my friend.
I rest my case. Thank you, Your Honour.
Thank you so much, Mark. Cheers.